Lab-grown meat is finally here, after years and years of development, money, and hope. But is it really going to be the silver bullet that wipes out the meat industry once and for all? Now, obviously, there are some glaring advantages to lab-grown meat, or so-called clean meat. For instance, a lab-grown burger can now be grown from only a few cells, which is exciting information because it means that we can have meat without paying for an animal to be killed. In fact, it's entirely possible to grow a turkey burger from the malted feather of a turkey, bringing the amount of initial animal suffering down to zero. But then, that brings us to our first problem. Animal cells are subject to the Hayflick effect, which states that cell division, or mitosis, can only occur a limited amount of times before breaking down by programmed cell death. However, occasionally cells will mutate and go unchecked, which is what we know as cancer. So if we are pushing cells to their limits, then the risk of these mutations increases. And the USDA doesn't allow manufacturers to knowingly sell food that contains cancer cells. This is mostly due to unknowns rather than observations, although certain types of cancer have been observed to spread like a contagious disease. Now, the risk of detrimental effects from consuming cancer is extremely low, since our stomach acid does a very good job of killing cells. Although, that said, I don't see anyone wanting to eat cancer. Now, just a quick note, you may be thinking that one way to get around the limits of cell division is to use stem cells, and you may be perfectly right. It just doesn't happen to be in place right now. Once we have the cells, they must be given a nutrient-rich cell culture medium, aka food. And at the moment, the industry standard for that is fetal bovine serum. Now, I'm sure you can see where I'm going with this. Fetal bovine serum is extracted by first killing a pregnant cow, then puncturing the heart of the still-living fetus without anesthesia, and then draining them of all their blood. You can see immediately that this still relies on killing animals, the very thing that lab-grown meat is thought to eradicate. But we don't necessarily have to use fetal bovine serum, since there are alternatives available. As far as my research goes, there are two cell culture mediums which aren't derived from animals. One is OptiPro SFM, and the other is Hyclone SFM 4 Mega Vire, or however you say that. However, neither of these are used in cultured meat just yet, although lab-grown meat companies do seem to be wanting to expand into non-animal-based alternatives. There are also two human-derived alternatives, if you can believe that. One is human serum albumin, a simple protein found in blood, and the other is human platalat lysates. Human platelet lysates, which is also extracted from human blood, but goes through a number of thaw and freeze cycles. On an ethical level, there would be no problem using these serums since they would come from consenting living humans, although I have a hard time believing that anyone would want to eat cultured meat grown in human blood derivatives. Now, it is important to note that lab-grown meat is not animal cruelty-free at this point in time, but I think it's also important to acknowledge the scope of things to come. For instance, it could be used to replace pet food, or even reduce wild animal suffering. Now, I'm not saying that we should compromise on killing animals or on animal cruelty, but I think it's important to be aware of what could happen if this product becomes animal cruelty-free. As we know, 2020 and the foreseeable future has been defined by COVID-19, a zoonotic disease. But not many of us are aware that 75% of diseases are of zoonotic origin. This includes swine flu, bird flu, Ebola, AIDS, foot and mouth, mad cow disease, and many seasonal flus. If we were to move away from traditional animal agriculture and towards lab-grown meats, especially as they become cruelty-free, we could eliminate all zoonotic diseases that come about from farming and the consumption of animals. So as a result of this, not only would human consumption of antibiotics be greatly reduced, but the demand for the 80% of total antibiotics that we currently feed to farmed animals would be eliminated. Now, while we're on the topic of health, lab-grown meat could one day potentially be genetically altered to contain less fat and even have nutrient fortification. However, we should note that at the moment, clean meat is made to be biologically identical to traditional meat. So that means it will still contain saturated fat, heme iron, and animal protein, all of which carry serious health concerns. Even if one day we could reduce all of these health concerns, it would be really difficult to imagine meat without cholesterol, since cholesterol is an important component of the cell membrane. Furthermore, processed meats such as sausages, hot dogs, ham, and deli meats are still a level 1 carcinogen, whether we use clean meats or not. This puts it in the same category as tobacco smoking and asbestos. Now, on the other hand, environmentally speaking, things are looking good. Cultured meat requires no space for movement, nor does it need to be fed in the same way as its animal counterpart. This frees up 80% of total agricultural land. In fact, cultured meat is calculated to produce 78 to 96% less carbon emissions. There is no con to this reduced environmental impact as far as I can see, but there are more cons in other areas. Now, the thing is, we already have plant-based meats, and some of them are so good that the general meat-eating public can't tell the difference.
No beef.
I've never had plant taste like beef before.
Tastes like a Whopper.
Tastes like a Whopper.
Tastes like a beef burger.
And even if plant-based meats are only 90% or even 80% similar, why would we spend all of this time, money, and effort on this much more complicated and morally ambiguous product? Couldn't the same people be working on improving, expanding, promoting, and bringing down the price of already existing plant-based products? Furthermore, from an ethical standpoint, couldn't it be argued that promoting animal flesh as food is unethical in itself? And shouldn't we as a society be moving away from animal products, not only for the rights of animals, but for the environment and human health as well? Now here's my own take on lab-grown meat. If you're still consuming animal products because you're waiting for lab-grown meat, you're just using it as an excuse. And if you're honest with yourself, the only reason that you still consume animal products is because you don't want to change. And I understand that because I made excuses myself. But at some point, I was just honest with myself, and I realized that I just couldn't keep eating animal products anymore.
So for me, as someone who is pro-animal rights, I won't be trying this while there is animal cruelty involved. And even after things progress and it becomes animal cruelty-free, I'm still not sure I'll try it, because just the thought of eating animal flesh is disgusting to me. But let me know what you think in the comments below, and don't forget to subscribe.